the Bishop of Derry, and Eamon Malley. And that's it for this week's Sunday. If you'd like to comment on the programme, you can email us at sunday@bbc.co.uk or write to us at Dockhouse Media City UK, Salford M50 2LH. And you can, of course, listen again or download the programme as a podcast from the BBC Sounds app. William Crawley will be in the chair next week. Enjoy the rest of your Sunday.
Sunday was produced by Dan Tierney and Louise Clarker-Botham, and the studio managers were Carwin Griffith and Mike Smith. Now, Benjamin Zephaniah makes the Radio 4 appeal on behalf of the charity Good Vibrations.
I'm a poet and writer, but when I left school I could barely read. My teacher said, "You're a born failure. You'll end up dead or doing a life sentence." When I went to Birmingham prison for burglary, I thought she was right. We've all struggled with lockdown, but imagine being locked up. One in four prisoners grew up in care, like Errol, who was lost, angry, with no prospects. Like me, people told him he'd go to prison, so he smashed shop windows and cars until it came true. He tried hard to make a life outside, but always reoffended. The charity, Good Vibrations, helped break that cycle by bringing the power of music into Errol's prison. Good Vibrations, used for Indonesian gamelan, a magnificent set of gongs, drums and xylophones. For Errol, it was eye-opening. As he says, you can't make music with someone and stay angry. You collaborate, find melody and rhythm together. At the final performance, you share the pride too. It's about building trust in others and confidence in yourself. For a whole week, you're more than prisoners. You're a dazzling gamelan orchestra. When Errol left prison in 2016, Good Vibrations involved him in other projects. He now performs as a spoken word artist and takes workshops into prisons himself, helping others find their potential. The arts transformed my life too. I remember the exact day I chose the road that led away from crime and towards this life of music and poetry. The pandemic has hit prisoners hard, but Good Vibrations is already working with prisons to restart face-to-face support. Your donation will help more people like Errol discover just what they're capable of. You can give now, and if it's difficult to post your donation, remember you can always give by phone by calling 0800 404 8144. Or you can give online by going to bbc.co.uk/appeal/radio4. Or you can write a cheque to Good Vibrations and send it to Free Post, BBC Radio 4 Appeal. And don't forget to mark the back of your envelope, Good Vibrations. Thank you.
Benjamin Zephaniah. Calls are free from landlines and mobiles. You can find all the details for giving online if you search for BBC Radio 4 Appeal. Remember, if you are a UK taxpayer and if you want Good Vibrations to collect the gift aid on your donation, please include an email or postal address so they can send you a gift aid form. Time now for the weather. Here's Stav Dinares.
Thank you very much, Neil. Good morning to you. Well, the heat wave is set to continue across more southern parts of Britain over the next few days, particularly in the southeast, with temperatures well above the average both by day and by night. Now, yesterday we saw a top temperature of 35 Celsius across the southeast. There was generally a bit more cloud across the southeast, which tends to thin and break into the afternoon, and that's when we did see more sunshine through a part two of the day. That's going to be how today is looking as well. Got quite a lot of cloud to start with across parts of central Wales, the Midlands, northern and eastern England, but it is gradually thinning and breaking now as we speak, and as we head on into the afternoon, it looks like many places will become sunnier. Other areas of the UK seeing a bit of cloud at times too. One notable area is western parts of Northern Ireland. Looks like eastern Northern Ireland should fare best with the sunshine. But generally speaking, much of the country will be dry, sunny, very warm into the afternoon. Temperatures into the low 20s for Scotland, Northern Ireland, far north of England. But for England and Wales, it will be considerably warmer, the mid to high 20s Celsius widely. And again, we're looking at the low to mid 30s Celsius across the southeast. One notable difference today is we've got more of a northeasterly breeze. It's a little bit fresher out there. That's going to make it feel quite cool along the North Sea coast. Now, as we head on into tonight, it's going to be warm, mainly dry, very humid, very muggy indeed across southern, southeastern parts of England. And there is a chance of the odd shower or thunderstorm developing across northern and western parts of the UK, but most places will be dry. As we head on into next week, it does look like we'll hold on to this warm and humid air mass. There is a chance of increasing amounts of thunderstorms developing next week, some of which could be heavy, so stay tuned to the forecast.
All right, many thanks, Stavrid Nares. Now, with a word about this morning's broadcasting house at 9, here's Paddy O'Connell. Good morning, Paddy.
Hello, Neil, and good morning to you. Well, let's just stick with the heatwave and the flood warning we've just heard from Stav. Lifeboat crews warn that beachgoers are throwing caution to the wind. I've been on the sands of Kent to find out more. Send in the Navy to turn back people smugglers, so says Admiral Lord West, who ran the Navy. Amid evidence of a new migrant crossing season, we'll hear from him just after 9. Lebanon's ambassador to the UK joins us to discuss the crisis in Beirut. We celebrate the Edinburgh Festival, which should have begun this weekend. We hear of a mini boom for estate agents as townies escape to the country. And the news review is in the hands of Dom Jolly, Sarah Vine and Paul Mason.
BBC News at 8 o'clock on Sunday, the 9th of August. Good morning, this is Diana Speed. Boris Johnson says getting children back into classrooms in England next month is the number one priority, and it's understood he would close pubs and shops to keep schools open. Brazil has recorded more than 100,000 deaths from coronavirus. Security forces in Lebanon have removed protesters who'd occupied government buildings as anger mounts over Tuesday's devastating explosion. Boris Johnson has said there is a moral duty to fully reopen schools in England next month. In a newspaper article, he said it could be done safely and was the national priority. It's understood the Prime Minister is prepared to shut pubs and shops in any future local lockdowns before considering closing schools. Government scientific advisers have suggested in recent weeks that keeping everything open would risk a new wave of coronavirus. Here's our political correspondent, Nick Eardley.
After failing to get all pupils in England back to school before the summer holidays, the Prime Minister has now made it a key test for the government, telling ministers there's no excuse not to see a full return next month. In today's Mail on Sunday, the Prime Minister writes, "Now that we know enough to reopen schools to all pupils safely, we have a moral duty to do so." In recent days, Boris Johnson is also understood to have made clear he wants schools to be the last sector to shut if lockdowns are needed in local areas. The Prime Minister believes the harm done to children's prospects and mental health is more damaging than the risk posed to them by the virus. Number 10 wants a more targeted approach when dealing with spikes in coronavirus, with measures focusing on specific areas and social interaction between households. In more serious cases, businesses like shops and pubs would be forced to close first, with schools remaining open for as long as possible.
Brazil has recorded 100,000 deaths from COVID-19. The country has now registered 3 million cases of the virus. Brazil is the worst affected nation after the US, and there's no sign of the virus slowing down. Katie Watson reports from Sao Paulo.
It took more than 3 months for Brazil to surpass 50,000 deaths, but less than 50 days to double that. The country is focusing on reopening and people are returning to work, despite the fact that the virus is still spreading and the pandemic is not thought to have reached the peak here. President Jair Bolsonaro has downplayed the virus from the very start. He's caught COVID-19 himself and recovered, but not even first-hand experience of it has changed his tune. Earlier in the week, Mr. Bolsonaro said he was sorry for all the deaths, but suggested everyone carried on with their lives. Clearly, the message from the top is that the economy takes priority over health.
The number of companies that notified the government about plans to cut jobs in June was 5 times higher than the same month last year. Information obtained by a Freedom of Information request found that more than 1,700 businesses in Great Britain told authorities about more than 139,000 planned cuts. That compares with 345 employers and 24,000 jobs the year before. Tony Wilson of the Institute for Employment Studies says the pandemic has accelerated change in some sectors.
there are a number of industries that have been directly affected by the crisis, where demand won't be returning, and they're now starting to lay people off. That's particularly the case in hospitality and in transport. I think this is also showing those industries that are having to restructure now, particularly in retail, the move to online shopping, the move away from high street shopping. So some of those jobs won't come back.
Security forces in Lebanon have taken back control of government ministries seized by protesters venting their anger about last Tuesday's devastating explosion in Beirut. The demonstrators accused politicians of negligence for allowing dangerous chemicals to be stored unsafely. From Beirut, here's our Middle East correspondent, Tom Bateman.
Groups of protesters surged towards Lebanon's parliament. They were met with tear gas and rubber bullets fired by security forces. Some demonstrators threw firecrackers and stones, and police said an officer was killed when he fell down a lift shaft after being chased in the nearby building. Demonstrators occupied several government ministries. On the streets, they demanded answers about the explosion and called for their leaders to go, chanting the words resign and revolution. The sense of fury is everywhere in a country that was already deeply mired in crisis well before Tuesday's blast.
Another 151 migrants managed to reach the UK yesterday by crossing the Channel in small boats. In just 3 days, more than 500 have made the journey. Researchers in Oxford are carrying out trials with an inexpensive asthma drug in the hope that it might also be effective in treating coronavirus. Volunteers with early symptoms of COVID-19 are being recruited to use the steroid called budesonide over a 4-week period. The researchers believe the drug could cut the number of hospital admissions in half. One of the volunteers, Rachel Hill, explains why she agreed to take part.
I'm very fit and well, and I know that I'll get over pretty much anything, but other people aren't so lucky. So I think it's very important that we all take part, if we can, in things like this, just so we increase the amount of knowledge we've got about disease.
President Trump has signed a series of executive orders aimed at helping millions of Americans affected by the coronavirus. The measures include eliminating payroll tax and extending benefit payments. It's not clear if Mr. Trump has the legal power to make such changes to spending, but he said he'd been forced to act because of the intransigence of his political opponents. The people of Belarus are voting today in presidential elections, with the incumbent Alexander Lukashenko, who's been in power since 1994, facing his toughest challenge yet. In the run-up to the polls, several rivals were either imprisoned or fled into exile, but there is still strong competition. Our Moscow correspondent Sarah Rainsford reports.
This election has developed into a challenge like Alexander Lukashenko has never known. His chief rival is a stay-at-home mum, who's only in the race because her husband was arrested to keep him out of it. But Svetlana Tikhanovskaya's campaign rallies have drawn record crowds across the country with a simple pledge: to release all political prisoners and then call a fresh, free and fair election. That prospect clearly appeals to many in Belarus after 26 years of authoritarian rule. President Lukashenko has mocked Svetlana Tikhanovskaya as a poor little girl, the puppet of foreign forces he claims are trying to spark a revolution.
Now for a look at the papers, and the Sunday Telegraph's lead is French ask for £30 million to police the Channel. It says the money would be for extra patrols on the country's northern beaches to stop migrants setting out in small boats to reach the UK. A Home Office source tells the paper that ministers have yet to decide how to respond to the demand. In its leader, the Telegraph accuses the French of plainly failing to police the sea routes to Britain, but it goes on to suggest that perhaps the solution lies in much closer cooperation with Paris. The Sunday Mirror warns that Britain could be heading for a second full coronavirus lockdown. A former government chief scientific adviser, Sir David King, says the only way to avoid it is to improve the test and trace system. This, he argues, must be achieved before schools in England reopen in September. Sir David is quoted saying, "The government has a month to deal with the level of infectivity as it stands now. Reopening schools should be a priority, but we believe we are nowhere near the point where it can be done safely." Under the headline, Boris warns, no excuses, the Sunday Express says the Prime Minister is fully committed to classes resuming next month. Downing Street, the paper explains, believes that schools are confident about their preparedness to reopen, including the safety measures being put in place. In its leader, the Express welcomes Mr Johnson's approach, suggesting that there cannot be an equivalent of the dog ate my homework in preventing youngsters returning to the classroom. There's a call on the front of the Observer for British travellers to be given compensation if they're visiting a country to which the government suddenly applies quarantine restrictions. MPs, scientists and trade unions say those caught out should receive 2 weeks statutory sick pay. The paper quotes the senior Conservative MP and former Brexit Secretary David Davis saying, if the government changes the rules while you're away and it costs you 2 weeks' work, then it's the government's responsibility. A Treasury spokesman tells The Observer, we keep quarantine rules under constant review. Anyone planning to travel should consider these risks. Writing in the Mail on Sunday, the Russian newspaper proprietor Yevgeny Lebedev attacks those who've criticised the recent decision to award him a peerage. Ms. Lebedev, who owns The Independent and the London Evening Standard and is a friend of the Prime Minister, dismisses the objections as a result of snobbery and casual racism. He also warns that a new wave of McCarthyism has emerged, with trials by the social media mob, followed by denouncements and confessions, which resemble the 1930s Stalinist show trials. And finally, the Sunday Times reports that Boris Johnson, his fiancée and their baby son are travelling to Scotland for a fortnight's holiday. Under the headline Johnson's Highland Fling, the paper's opinion column suggests there may be an ulterior motive for the trip. Plenty of Scots have a grievance against Boris Johnson, it says, and he will hope that if he takes the high road and holidays north of the border, it could win some around. And that's our look at the papers.
Many thanks, Diana Speed. Time now on BBC Radio 4 for Sunday Worship, which explores the cross and black liberation, with the Archdeacon of Croydon, the Venerable Dr. Rosemary Mallett, Anglican Ordinan Augustine Tanaim, and David Chisanya, a co-founder of the Street Pastors Movement. The service includes gospel music and spirituals from iconic American artists and British gospel stars, and is led by Ginny MacDonald, Head of Public Engagement at Christian Aid.